Can you see?
Good afternoon, respected doctors. On behalf of Brinton Pharmaceuticals, I welcome you all, esteemed delegates, in today's webinar on non-contoured epidermal cell suspension method. Dear doctors, as you all would agree on the fact that vitiligo just not fades away the color from one's skin, but also from his or her life, isn't it? And who else than you would be knowing it better, as you all must be coming across vitiligo cases daily and experiencing their pain and agony very closely. Vitiligo management is a challenging subject, and Brinton Pharmaceuticals, with an intent to uphold the scientific knowledge dissemination, are indeed humbled to welcome all respected doctors and postgraduate dermatology students for a series of master classes in vitiligo. This program will help incite interest in young dermatologists and postgraduate students to take up vitiligo management towards better care of individual affected by vitiligo. I would not spend time in explaining the prevalence and current treatment approaches, as we have a stalwart with us today who holds high authority to talk on the vitiligo subject. I'm delighted to welcome Dr. G. Ravichandran sir, who is senior consultant in dermatology from Apollo Hospitals, Chennai, who would be taking this series of master classes starting from today. Dr. Ravichandran would be enlightening us in the first master class today on the subject of non-cultured epidermal cell suspension method. It's an innovative surgical technique that is used for the treatment of vitiligo. Apart from this, Dr. Ravichandran would be taking 5 more master classes in the upcoming months on the subjects like punch skin grafts, ultra thin epidermal skin grafts, blister grafts and hair follicle melanocyte cell grafts, medical therapy, and recent advances in vitiligo. Dr. Ravichandran is one of the leading vitiligo and pigmentary disorder specialists in India. He needs no introduction when we speak of dermatology. His work spanning more than 35 years in the field of dermatology has been appreciated all across India and beyond. Before I hand over this session to Dr. Ravichandran, let me formally brief you all about Dr. Ravichandran's achievement. Dr. Ravichandran has graduated from the Madras Medical College in 1980, completed his MBBS in 1980. Then he did his diploma in dermatology in 1984, followed by MD in 1989. He has been a postgraduate teaching faculty in the Department of Dermatology in Stanley Medical College, Chennai for more than 15 years and took VRS in the professor rank. Dr. Ravichandran has got trained under Professor P.N. Behel's Institute of Dermatology, which is a prestigious institute from India. He has conducted many dermatosurgical workshops for dermatologists and many more CMAs. He has been examiner for the fellowship in the dermatosurgery, Bangalore Medical College and Rajiv Gandhi Medical University. He has conducted many national and international presentations and publications. He has been co-author in the dermatology chapter of Apollo Hospitals textbook of medicine. He has been conferred with Professor Dr. Patrick Esudian First Oration Award, QTCon TN Tamil Nadu 2015 on past, present and future on vitiligo. Dr. Ravichandran was awarded as the best dermatologist Chennai award, which was presented by Tamil Nadu Health Secretary in 2017. He has a special interest in vitiligo surgery and cutaneous oncology. Dr. Ravichandran is life member of various prestigious associations like Indian Association of Dermatologists, Venereologists and Leprologists. Apart from that, he is a life member of Associations of Cutaneous Surgeons of India, Indian Medical Association, the Hair Research Society of India, World Vitiligo Research Foundation, New York, USA. Dr. Ravichandran has also conducted many clinical trials with Apollo Spectra. Now, before I hand over the session to Dr. Ravichandran, sir, if you have any questions during or after the session, please type in the comment box below the video. We shall try to accommodate as many questions as we can. And if any questions still remain unattended, you can contact Dr. Ravi Chandran on his email ID, raviskindoc@gmail.com. I will repeat the email ID, that is raviskindoc@gmail.com. Now I would hand over the session to Dr. Ravi Chandran, sir. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, Rohan. Good afternoon to everybody. Thank you so much for your kind introduction, a very warm welcome, and a good afternoon to everyone, the viewers, the people, delegates who are watching across India and other places. Thank you from my heart that I wanted to acknowledge your presence today, even afternoon. Thank you so much. This is a very interesting topic, and this is chosen, actually it's a long pending thing from my side, so it's close to my heart. Vitiligo is a very good subject, very close to my heart, and I always cherish this topic and try to deliver and whatever best we can do to the patient, needy patients, and then probably to the our dermatological consultants. Thank you. I will just proceed to start sharing the slides, and we will go probably to take around 40 to 45 slides to go about it. And step by step, any you can always interrupt during my talk, and I'm going to play some technical videos so that you can also learn how it is to be done. All these techniques I am going to demonstrate today online. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Yes. My slide is visible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Very interesting cell, no? This is a very unique cell. So I am going to bring the color back. How to bring the color back to a depigmented skin? So the secret is lies on this melanocyte, no? The pigment producing cell, which is derived from a neuroectoderm. It travels down for far away from the neuroectoderm to the basal layer as well as the basal layer of the hair follicle. What an amazing event it does when you to get the pigmentation onto the skin. Depending upon the melanocyte structure and the delivery of melanosomes and the pigmentation, we have the classification of Fitzpatrick 1 to 6. So that shows that this is a very important that how it is going to matter to us ethically and as well as ethnically and other places. So this, I am going to come back to the topic of new advances in the management of vitiligo. All of you are familiar with this cell, so we will go ahead and then try to unfold what it is going to do, what can be done, if it is lost, what can be done, and if it is still not functioning, what amount of treatment we can allow to stimulate it to bring back the pigmentation. Yes, to begin with, always definition is very important. You all know that vitiligo is a deep pigmentary disorder. Those days when we were postgraduate students of unknown etiology, unknown origin. But now it has been clearly defined as an autoimmune phenomenon wherein multiple factors play a role in bringing out this depigmentation, loss of melanocyte. Vitiligo is the most common disfiguring depigmentation of the skin characterized by acquired white patches with an unpredictable course. I insist this because as we start treating these patients with vitiligo, whether depending upon the type, suddenly this can behave in a different way. So that is why we may not be able to predict its course. You say, that's the reason that I put this statement, a very apt statement for this young boy who has got a small segmental vitiligo for many years. As you can see, perifollicular pigmentation, as repigmentation starts after topical and topical phototherapy. You know that vitiligo has got different phases. As you can see, it has got different phases. The clinical spectrum of vitiligo is wide, and we have many types. As you can see in the left side of the photograph, a segment of vitiligo on the lip as well as the hairs have become depigmented. That shows the process of autoimmunity, the destruction of the melanocytes goes down to the hair roots, causing depigmentation of the hair. Another patient who's got the lack of facial called the lip vitiligo. He started with both the lips and subsequently developed on the acral area. Though we classified them as started with acrofacial vitiligo, subsequently this has unfolded into a generalized vitiligo. This is also quite often we see most of the dermatologists able to see these patients because this is a very difficult topic to treat this. Okay, another patient, I wanted to put a small slide on that. So this lady has applied hair color. She's developed depigmentation of the scalp hair. And still, in spite of the depigmentation on the scalp skin, she wants to dye the hair with a PPD chemical. So it's a PPD-induced secondary depigmentation. So it's mind-boggling that there are multiple factors play a big role in causing the destruction of the melanocytes. Again, see why? See this, you see a picture on the left side, you can see the depigmentation of the hair spontaneously on its own, but it's getting a little defined here and there because the process can definitely stop and it may not proceed to develop into larger areas. So that's one area. Whenever we see a white presence of white hairs on a patch, that means there are amelanotic melanocytes. The treatment with topical as well as topical phototherapy, whatever medical treatment you do, it may not be very successful. So as you can see, one of my friend calligraphed this patient to me. A periaqueal, it's in the areolar region, wherein it has also crossed the areolar border and causing depigmentation. But I'm able to see the presence of dark hairs there. Someone has performed a small punch skin grafting called 2 mm or 3 mm, I do not know. But you can see the depigmentation happening on this transplanted skin. That shows that the onto, though it looks very stable by looking at the hair, okay, this is a condition wherein you have the pigments is retained in the hair roots. It can be brought back. It's stable, but it is not a stable vitiligo. As you can see, this is the depigmentation of the punch grafted skin that's called reverse Koebner phenomenon. So this is a very interesting. We have to observe these kind of interesting features in any given patient and then classify them so that your approach will be very planned very well so that you get a good results at the end of the day. Okay, another extensive vitiligo patient who's got a young lady of 25 years old, extensive generalized vitiligo. She had small islands of repigmentation or maybe retention of the skin color, but she was very clear that I don't want pigmentation. I started removing this pigmentation by treatment options are available. When you go to the last topic of medical management, I will tell you how to remove this pigmentation. This is a case of piebaldism. Of course, she's got a little pigmentation. Piebaldism, there are many, many case reports of depigmentation in different settings. So these are all patients we need to do some kind of an approach. So I evaluate them and try to help them. This is another patient with an halonevus. So this boy, young man, developed a small depigmentation around the junctional levi, compound junctional levi. He started a coin-shaped depigmentation called halonevus. Halonevus remains there for long years as halonevi with a Sutton's nevus otherwise called. But after a year or so, he has developed few stray patches here and there in the body. That means he has developed a good antibody against the melanocytes of the nevus cells and also spreading antibody against the normal circulating melanocytes, which circulates and destroys the depigmented patches at the distant sites. That is why we address this melanocytic nevi. The options will be, we always give subtopical treatment, and if it's still there, I think my recommendation will be to yearly removal of this nevi so that the autoimmune process can be halted. Okay, before we go into depth of the topic of medical and surgical options in vitiligo, first, one must understand the basic pathophysiology of vitiligo. So what does it show? It involves a chronic loss of melanocytes in the areas of depigmentation. We all understand vitiligo is a chronic depigmentation disorder, wherein it might start in a simple, small, hypopigmented, confetti-like or a gutted vitiligo. Subsequently, it can produce to a generalized vitiligo. So that is why we talk about chronic loss of melanocytes. Vitiligo macules could pass through two stages. The first stage, this is the normal skin. You see the small pigmented melanocytes shown everywhere in the skin. And this is the First stage is reversible with partial melanocyte loss. As you can see in the vitiligo picture there, melanocytes are decreased in number, and probably if it is retained and stimulated, it will be very successful to repigmenting the whole depigmented patch. That is why medical therapy forms a sheet anchor prior, during, and after treatment by surgical treatment. So when do you want to intervene to do some surgical intervention? As a dermatologist, you have the knowledge and experience to bring back the color. So the second stage involves irreversible with total loss of melanocytes. You see here, completely the depigmented skin is devoid of pigment producing cells called melanocytes. So there you start doing some kind of a technique so that we can retain this to get back the pigmentation there. So this is going to be my basic pathology, understanding this pathology, so that when and where and how to transfer the, get this pigmentation back onto the vitiligo skin. Medical treatments are ineffective in many patients, and sometimes surgical methods have to be resorted. So this is a very interesting, as I unfold into the further slides, you will know that how to go about this topic, so that in subsequent lectures also we will understand the whole concept of this condition. Okay, coming to the today's topic will be on current surgical modalities, and I am also going to explain only to the first topic of I will tell you that we have classification of the surgical modalities. We have to plan depending upon the patient's age, the site of vitiligo, and what type of procedure you wanted to show. So how do you classify? Classification is an orderly way of thinking. That's why my professor used to say, Professor Tambaya. So we classify them into tissue grafts. Under tissue grafts, we have a thin and ultra-thin epidermal grafts called STSG. And then we have the suction blister epidermal grafts called SBEG. Then we have the mini punch grafts called MPG. And hair follicle grafts called HFG. So this is regarding the tissue. We have to transfer the tissue containing the pigment producing cells to a depigmented. These methods always can be done, and it is also very useful. The beginners can definitely venture into this kind of techniques. It's a user friendly, very simple. I'll be subsequently taking into all these topics in the subsequent lecture. Okay, coming to another type of cellular grafts, we have the non-cultured epidermal cell suspension called non-cultured NCES. This is, I am going to discuss about this topic today as a first master class on vitiligo. The second one is the cultured pure melanocytes, and the third one is cultured epithelial grafts. The fourth one is called autologous non-cultured extracted hair follicle outer sheath cell suspension. We will try to give you a kind of an approach, practical demonstration, as well as techniques of doing these kind of procedures. Before we venture what type of procedures one has to choose, we need to discuss with this patient. Before a surgical treatment is planned, several points should be considered and discussed with the patient. We all understand that patient is the important person, is an esteemed customer to our organization. So please, that too, vitiligo patients are psychologically upset, and psychologically they have low quality of life, so that please let them feel very comfortable with you and explain properly, okay, this has been there for long years, we tried everything and it is not showing up much results, so that I am planning or intending to go for a replacement of some kind of a technique, so that we try to get the pigmentation there. So this is an important sheet anchor in the management of the patient with surgery, before surgery, during surgery, and after surgery. This holds very, very good. The second should be clearly, the patient should be clearly explained about the nature of the procedure, expected outcome, and the possible side effects. Most of them generally ask you, doctor, how much it will cost, what will be the procedure like, how will be the results, how long it will take, and what will be the side effects. Each topic we have to discuss with the patient, and the patient's relative, a young boy or a girl is there, the parents must be, because they are very anxious. Young girl of a marriageable age, the mother is very concerned, so that we have to first of all bring them to a nice understanding so that the success depends upon this type. The choice of surgical intervention should be individualized, as I was telling you in the beginning, the vitiligo type. What are the types? Is it we classify vitiligo into generalized vitiligo, segmental vitiligo, and non-segmental vitiligo? So depending upon that, you explain to them, this is the condition and this is how I'm going to treat. I'm not going to go into the surgery right now. One time, maybe at a later date, you might have to go for a surgery. So you can always discuss this in the first few sessions. Then we talk about stability of the lesion, sites involved, localization of the lesions, cost effectiveness of the procedure. Stability. My friends, colleagues from PGIMS, AIIMS always discuss about our Association of Cutaneous Surgeons. I've clearly described the points with regard to the stability. Initially, stability of the lesions were thought about the disease 2 years. Now it's been reduced to a year or so. Even in that, Somesh Gupta always says that stability can be a lesional stability or a general stability. That has to be assessed. When I go into the technique of procedure, I will tell you how to assess the stability before you proceed to go for a surgery. The sites involved, all of us, we know, showed some pictures of vitiligo where it's very commonly seen that these are the common types. The localization of lesions, cost effectiveness of the procedure. Patient selections for this new technique, which has been world over appreciated, particularly in tropical countries, since depigmentation is a very obvious condition. This is becoming very interesting, and we are all blessed to have our training done by our elders and teachers, and we have a very good team in India. And I think we have done excellent in these workshops and other procedures. So we talk about stable vitiligo. The indications are exactly, you have to be very, very clear enough that when and where, how to do this. So you choose a patient who's got a stable vitiligo. The commonest one, the best response is segmental vitiligo. Then we have the focal vitiligo. Sometimes if it's stable mucosal areas, you can always go for either a oral or a genital mucosal involvement. Eyelids are very, very good response. Acral area are very difficult, but you can always try and do multiple techniques. So if it's disease is stable, you can always go ahead with this simple transfer. If the areas are stable and showing evidence of, how do you assess the patch which is stable? You see small patches of brown pigmentation at the borders or in the perifollicular areas. That shows that with medical therapy or spontaneous, that shows the stable patches are there. If there are, when will you avoid unstable? How do you say that it's unstable vitiligo? Development of new patches, the patches which repigmented disappearing, and the presence of Kubner phenomenon. I always ask for the patient to see the patient's whole skin. He must have had a small Kubner phenomenon 2 weeks ago. That shows that you are is not a candidate for. So whenever you don't look for the Kubner phenomenon, you start doing the procedure, even the donor area, as I told you in one picture, it can depigment. Larger areas may require multiple procedures. Definitely, stage by stage we can do. We can start doing from the exposed sites, which is cosmetically disfiguring for a young boys or a girl. I think this is definitely, you can always start with a exposed site until I go for this procedure. What are the equipments required? My postgraduate students and young consultants always, because this is very interesting that one must learn about what are the things you require. So you have to have a small surgical tray. In that we have an autoclave stainless steel cups you should have, or a sterile disposable cups. We have to have one or two straight clamps to hold the blades, small scissors, curved mosquito scissors, skin grafting knife, or shaving blades where you can autoclave this, or maybe you can, ETO sterilization can be done prior and bring it on the day of surgery, or it's all available in the operation theaters. You have to train your staffs, theater staffs and attendants must be explained, teach them what you are going to do. And jewelers, forceps to tease out these pigment cells. Once I go, you will see all the instruments playing a big role in this isolating the melanocytes. Glass petri dishes are a disposable ones, very important. You can always do all these things by ETO sterilization. Most important, you should have a very good incubator, tissue incubator, culture incubator available freely everywhere, and the temperature is set to 37 degrees. Please keep your own incubator, never mix it with the microbiology lab, because sterility is very, very important. You need to have a buffered normal saline or a normal saline, a betadine antiseptic solution, whatever convenient you want to do, sterilize the donor and the recipient sites. And of course, to do this procedure of melanocyte cell transplantation, the main thing is the tissue culture media. You have to procure this media, because they're all cold storage media available across the world, across India. And what are the things we need to buy? We need to keep it in a refrigerator in the form of a trypsin EDTA 0.25% solution, a bottle of trypsin inhibitor, and the Delby Coast modified Eagles medium. These are all available for multiple labs, in vitrogen or a Sigma lab. Very easy, you can go to the website of Sigma Labs and choose these agents in order, so that it is delivered from the stockist in a cold storage. You have to freeze this trypsin and trypsin inhibitor in the freezer compartment. Eagles medium can be stored in the regular tray. Just before the procedure, you can always transfer it half an hour prior to that, because it's solidified and frozen, and make sure it don't start doing and wait for half an hour to get the trypsin, which is crystallized. Yes, a small tray containing all the needed stuff. So this is the Delby Coast Eagles medium. You can buy a 500 bottle from Sigma Labs. Can be stored in the fridge for a period of, there's an expiry date for a period of 6 months or so, it can be reused. Once you take it in a small container, you can immediately transfer it, can go back to the refrigerator. And we have the two small things, solutions called trypsin EDTA and the trypsin inhibitor. You take this 30 minutes before, so that then only it liquefies, so that it is easy to use it. So you have a small glass petri dish. Then we have this jeweler's forceps, a pipette, a test tube, small glass petri dishes. This is just like this, which are of course the other things, surgical tray I told you. It is available in every part of the theater, or you can also have your minor operation theater to have all these things. This is the basic equipment. Of course, I'm not showing the incubator picture. It's all of us know that what is an incubator is. Dressings, very, very important, because quite a number of times we have to adhere to strict protocol how to perform dressing at different sites. That is why we require it. Once you prepare, get ready of a transparent collagen sheets. We have lots of companies manufacturing transparent collagen. I prefer transparent collagen because we know that how much of a melanocyte has transferred under the dermabraded skin. We have a tulle dressings so that when you remove the dressing on the donor area and recipient site, it is easy to remove it so that it doesn't cause hurt or pain during the removal. Media, as I told you, is to be stored in the fridge. The incubator is set at 37 degrees centigrade. Post-operative care is very, very important. Dressing, doctors always ask you, when can I? Small thing, you can always write a small instruction leaflet so that you can type it and send it to the patient, give it to that at the time of the discharge, so that they also understand how to keep that safe. How to not to wet this place, all these general instructions. It's very easy. Maybe for the beginner, this might be necessary. Removed on the 10th day from the donor and the recipient sites. So generally we perform this in a full operation theater, because we require a sterile environment, because most of the operation theaters have HEPA filter and other things. Or if you have a minor operation theater, you can sterilize it previous day with the techniques which the always the theater technicians or the staff nurses will be able to help you. You can also have a laminar flow so that it, when you separate the cells, a laminar flow is also very useful, particularly if you want to do a culture melanocytes. The main thing is the anesthesia. Topical EMLA, eutectic mixture of local anesthetics, was a very big boon to all the dermatologists. Whether you wanted to do a laser resurfacing, or give a botulinum toxin injections or chemical peels or procedures like skin grafting. So this has to be used as a topical MLAC cream. I tell you when I go to the next slide. Local infiltration is also very useful with the 2% xylocaine, because this will be very useful for a large area of skin, particularly for the donor area. And sometimes you have to call the anesthetist. We have always, if you go into a large procedure, so we always have an anesthetist to back you up. For general anesthesia for larger area of skin grafting, it might take 2 to 3 hours to complete. Theater staffs must be, as I told you, plays a vital role. You have to train them like what we do for hair transplantation. It's a teamwork. So that hassle-free, step-by-step, everything goes smoothly well. If you have more than one patient, smooth flow of patients into the theater, in and out will be very happy, will be done very fast. Pre-operative and post-operative bed facility, the patients can be kept for 30 minutes to 1 hour. If it's a small area, they can be sent home after that. If there's a large area that you are going to give general anesthesia, patients need to be admitted overnight so that next day you go for rounds and you can discharge the patients. So coming to the main topic of surgical procedure, so you have to first ask the patient to come and then identify the donor and the recipient sites, apply topical MLAC cream, minimum 1 hour to 2 hours. Always when the children are there, please take time to do, because donor epidermal graft under 1 hour, it is comfortable, but I would like to recommend more than 90 minutes to 120 minutes. Then only complete anesthesia up to the upper dermis, just in the reticular dermis, it will be very effective. For ultra-thin effect, it's very useful for ultra-thin and epidermal grafts, because MLA plays a major role. So the pain of injection-free can be easily attempted. And then once you take the small skin graft and then put it in a small sterile cups, you know, I told you stainless steel or disposable. And then it has to be, then we have to add that trypsin EDTA around 5 to 10 ml onto that, and then transfer that ultra-thin epidermal graft onto the petri dish, onto the glass, you know, the cups, the sterile cups, and take it to the incubator and skip it for minimum of 30 minutes to 1 hour, depending upon the thickness of the graft. Whether if you're going to take a partial thickness, it might take more than 1 hour for the trypsin to act and separate the epidermis and dermis. If you're going to take a small ultra thin, it may take hardly 30 minutes. The melanocytes and keratinocyte cells are separated in 0.25 ml of tissue culture medium called the Delbecose Eagles medium and aspirated in a 1 ml syringe. You can also transfer it to a small glass container called the test tube and then go for a centrifugate technique. So now off late, I don't use the centrifugation. There are a lot of different modifications. When we talk to the question and answer, I will explain to you. Aspirated in 1 ml syringe and then apply over dermabraded patches. Dermabrasion is generally performed with a hand dermabrader. We always comfortable with a micromotor, dental micromotor with a straight handpiece. Different sizes of dermabrasion burrs are available. Of course, from our local providers are available. You have also international companies also coming out with the diamond phrases called different shapes, different quality, smooth, rough, and medium sizes. So that depending upon the area of skin, you wanted to use a lip mucosa abrasion, you can use a fine one. If you want to do a small dorsum of the finger, hand, or foot, you might use a strong one, the thicker one. And it is generally covered with a transparent. Once you transfer that, the donor area also is being application of the transparent collagen, you have to apply a regular dressing. A simple explanation, this is the petri dish containing the dermal part, the cellular separation method. It is taken in a small 1 ml disposable insulin syringe and you start dermabrasion with a diamond burr or a micromotor with a diamond phrase till pinpoint bleeding starts. And with that, dribble this paint, drop it slowly. You can also spread it like that. And once it is totally covered, and start a small trans. You hold the trans. I will just going to demonstrate video so that you will understand the how it is generally done. And then put the transparent collagen on top of the chest. Hope it is very clear. If anything you wanted to ask, please send a small chat message. I will replay the same set of slides and discuss about it. How to harvest the donor skin? There are different methods of donor skin area. Choosing the donor area is a very tricky and interesting because you have to avoid certain areas. If you are going to take a small bit of skin, it's well and good. The hairy area of the thighs, lateral aspect of thighs or the gluteal area is comfortable for men. For women, I would not like to scar the front of the thighs or the gluteal region. I would like to take a skin from the scalp or from the retroauricular area. How to harvest? There are even, we have the typical surgical knife is there, theater knives are there, or this is a dermatologist. This always has been clearly defined by my professor and guide, Professor P. N. Bell. I learned this technique from P. N. Bell way back many, many years. I still practice it because it gives with ease with which I take it. It's hardly take few minutes, 1 to 2 minutes, we can always harvest the skin. Sir, I'm not very comfortable. I don't know how to do this. Do not have to worry. If you are very comfortable with a punch grafting, use a 3 millimeter or 2 millimeter or 4 millimeter punch. Do a small punch grafting, take it out with the punches and trim the basal layer up to the fat and the dermis. You can always transfer it to the trypsin EDTA solution. Now I will just show you how this is. You need a straight clamp. This is a straight artery clamp. Hold it. The blade, autoclaved ETO stainless blade, and keep it on that. You have to have a seesaw movement from your shoulder, from your elbow, so that it goes in successions, so that you take a small epidermal grafts. And then you have to take a very thin grafts, because suppose what I will tell you. So why is the purpose of taking an ultra thin graft? This is because suppose if you always store always the specimens are, even the hair transplant surgeons store around half a dozen or 10 or 15 hairs in the case of there's a kind of a re-implantation like that. I always take a bit of the skin, store it in normal saline buffer so that if the melanocyte separation is not happening well, you can always transfer this as an epidermal graft, the same technique. So patient need not be sent back, okay, I'm not able to separate the cells. It's a failure. Don't have to tell. Keep a watch so that you can always transfer these deep epidermal grafts onto the dermabrasive sites. Okay, you can watch now. I would like to replay it again. Young postgraduates must start doing this. See such a transparent skin. You can see the letters of the blade just underneath. And you just cover it with a bhakti grass or a tuli dressing and then start putting a small gamji pad, and it has to secure with a dynaplast. You can always do. Preferably, as I told you, gluteal region, outer 1/3 for the men and women. Men. For women, if it's a small area, you can always take from the same site. Otherwise, take it from the retroauricular or a skin from the scalp, covered areas. Hope you are able to see this well. Yes, so this is a small, so that we have taken that small ultra thin, transfer it into a small container, a petri dish or a cup, sterile cup with a normal buffered saline. Keep it for a few, wash it, rinse it very, very well till the blood pigments goes away. And then you are already having a small 10 ml of a 0.25 trypsin EDTA solution. Immerse that into that. Make sure the the undersurface is floating upwards, so that when you put it in the incubator, the cell, the effect will be much, much better. So that you transfer it to a sterile cup with the trypsin EDTA, take it to the same theater you will have your incubator, place it inside the theater so that the staff nurse will open it. You have to on the incubator, switch on the incubator the previous day, because then only the temperature will be maintained. Just before, after keeping it, don't switch off, because cell separation may not be very successful. These small, small practical tips I will try to give you. Then that's way by which we transfer. If you do cannot able to take an ultra thin, take, as I told you, 10 to 15 punch grafts, trim the basal layer, a little bit of the fat as well as the dermis, and then float it in the trypsin EDTA, keep it in the incubator. Incubate it for 30 minutes to 1 hour for 37 degrees centigrade. This is a small segmental vitiligo, young boy, who is very, you can also see the small follicular repigmentation here and there, but we have, this is a very, because if long, if it is there for many years, you can always do a dermabrasion, do an ultra thin graft or an epidermal graft. This is a straight hand piece from dental. As you can see, I am using a small pear-shaped diamond bar into that, so that if you go into the lip margin and all, other burrs may cut through the skin, so that there will be a small injury. So to avoid injury, you have to use, have this, and always wear a goggle or a, very important, because the blood products can go into your eye. Make sure you have a theater goggles. The operator and the staff nurses must be clearly using all these guidelines. You can also use a hand dermabrader, or you can also use a carbon dioxide laser abrasion or erbium, anything you can do. But I would definitely prefer a diamond burr dermabrasion, so that the take of the graft, whether for the ultra thin or in melanocytes, will be very, very good. There's a new technique which I will tell you at the end of the day. Suppose, sir, I am not very comfortable with all these things. I'm going to tell you when in the question and answer session. Okay. This is an area where epidermal melanocyte, keratinocyte cell suspension. After 1 hour of incubation in the incubator, take the slide with skin, small sample of skin you have kept it inside, and transfer it into a glass in a container where normal buffered saline. Do 2-3 times rinsing, and then put it in the trypsin inhibitor, so that the action of trypsin is inhibited. So that is why we have a small tray trypsin inhibitor. Then transfer it to the next slide where it contains the Delbicose Eagle's medium. In that, you float it and take your jeweler's forceps and start teasing out the cells, as you can see here in this video. I would like to replay you and just give you some small tips. As you can see here, you can see the dermis, white glistening tissue is the dermis. It gets, as you can see here clearly, here, the now you can see very clearly, the brown pigmented, both epidermal melanocytes and keratinocytes are clearly separated so that we can discard the sheets of white dermis so that you don't have to take it. So this can be taken, the cell separated, that lies there. You can absorb it in a, take it in a small 1 ml syringe, or if you wanted to add more of melanocyte delbicose equus medium, you can always take it in a test tube so that it can be sent for centrifuging. Centrifuging also can be avoided because damage to melanocytes are very common. That is why as soon as you transfer it, try to transfer it to the derm abraded sites. So sometimes the results may not be very good. Why? Because the incubation would have destroyed the tissue. High temperature, long duration of incubation can be damaging the sensitive, melanocytes are very sensitive keratinocytes. So this, or if you still wanted, I have done a small isolation of these melanocyte keratinocytes and gone to the histopathology department and tried whether they are separated well, are they viable with the S100 protein stain or melanin stain, so that you will know just before you wanted to venture out large areas, you can always experience these events. Yes, one more, you see, these are the tissues which is to be discarded. Actually, so much dermis is being discarded and this is a small epidermal. Sometimes you have a flaky skin, depends upon the type of incubation, quality of the skin. So much of white dermis separates like a tissue paper, and I have cleared these areas nicely. It takes at least 5 to 10 minutes to separate a 1 inch of skin which is harvested and incubated. Yes, the fourth technique is transfer of cell-rich suspension over dermabraded vitiligo patches. You have dermabraded the patch and you have to take it in a 1 ml of a, you see small, probably the patient has got a dark skin. You see so much of dark melanocytes, keratinocytes, and you can see the dermabraded patch and start spreading this some small layer of tissues will be there. You can always keep it there as an epidermal graft. Make sure that it doesn't dribble. Sometimes it can dribble down on the, this is how the collagen sheet is placed. Keep the collagen sheets so that you can place it like that. More than one collagen sheet can be applied. See, the nurse, staff nurse is helping you to do the other areas. Yes. Hold it below so that it doesn't go wastage. Waste can be really prevented. Yes. Yes. It's a large area. Cut your transparent collagen and place it wherever you have not transferred the, see the nice fluid going away. So this is a very important procedure because one has to understand. Sometimes it is, if you use little more of the delbicose eagles medium, it will be more fluid in nature. For that, they are hyaluronic acid also. They can also add patient's own serum. But every step becomes more difficult so that the steps in doing that should be very simple to you. Simple from the point, from the patient's point of view, as well as the staff, our staff who are assisting me must also have a simple way by which they help you. So this is a very important topic that I always prefer not to centrifuge. You can always, there is no hard and fast rule. I'm able to get a 1 to 2 ml of a nice suspension of melanocyte keratinocytes so that it can be transferred to any more areas. And make sure, one simple point I wanted to say now, is you have taken out more cells like in this patient, so much of cells is there. And please don't put it across. See, I don't want it to waste. I wanted to put everything, all the thing which I have separated onto the dermabraded sites. And after treatment and after repigmentation, the patch will become hyperpigmented. The more the melanocytes, the more the reproduction, repigmentation following treatment. So adequate amount of transfer is very important. In fair-skinned individuals, you may not be able to visualize the color of the melanin there. So it will be very light. Don't worry about that. It will be a light-colored pigmentation there, depending upon the quality or the type of the skin you are going to handle. After doing this collagen dressing, take a bacteria grass or a paraffin gauze, play a layer, and on top put a small gauze piece, one or two, and do a small tight. Don't press too much. When you do a very hard, strong dressing, all the material will be used out, goes into the gauze piece. So it's a waste of time. So just place it nicely. Even you can wait for 10-15 minutes on the table so that it gets adhered. That is why techniques of adding hyaluronic acid, patient serum, helps to adhere the cell suspension onto the dermabraded sites. Yes, so after removing the dressing after the 10th day, you can always see a small tinge of brown sheets of pigmentation there, which is uniform and smooth. We get very excellent repigmentation with a good color match and with a good texture quality after doing this transfer technique. It is most suited for segmental and focal vitiligo, which is resistant to treatment, particularly on these exposed sites. The color match is very, very good. You can spontaneous repigmentation, you can always see. If you wanted to stimulate, you can give, if it is a delayed repigmentation, after a few months, 4 to 6 weeks, you will see a nice color coming up. If not, you can start with a topical phototherapy or a narrowband UVB phototherapy, or an examine laser or targeted phototherapy. Depending upon the availability, you can always get the color, stimulate the pigment cells, melanocytes, to get an uniform perigraft migration of melanin pigmentation. As I told you, it can be done at any patch of vitiligo, which is very stable. As I told you, stability has to be assessed. How to assess stability? I told you, follicular repigmentation, no new patches, and then no presence of Kubner phenomenon. And if you're still uncertain, the patient wants guaranteed results, you do a Falabella's technique, which I learned long years ago. Professor Falabella is a man who has devised test punch grafting before you assess the stability, so that it can take 2-3 punches and try to put it onto the depigmented skin, wait for a few weeks. And if there's a like a punch skin grafting, I'll be explaining to that next session, the class, wherein you have a perigraft migration, then you are good enough to proceed with this technique, where it will be time consuming and also takes a good gives a good repigmentation. Just to show you, we have a lot of slides. I don't want to show you so many slides. As you can see, this young boy with a long segmental vitiligo from early childhood, he's around 16 years when he came to me. Why it's not repigmented? The white, the leukotrichia. The leukotrichia hair is the reason that I was just telling in the first slide. A patch which is devoid of melanocytes. There's complete lot of melanocytes. One has to attempt this procedure, which is very satisfying to the patient and to the consultant dermatologist who is trained to do this procedure. This is after 3 months. He came back to me from North India. So you can see a nice, smooth, uniform. Sometimes I told you, one can observe a little more darker hyperpigmentation. Oh, that could be probably, I must have transferred a large amount of cell suspension there, or this patient must not have been using a good sunscreen, or maybe overexposing, overenthusiastic phototherapy must have been attempted. And you can always observe that the hairs also slowly getting repigmented. That shows that retrograde migration of melanin, melanocytes, goes in down to the hair bulb and start repigmenting on the white hairs, which slowly getting. I have seen quite a number of patients repigmenting very, very well. If their hairs are not getting okay, you can always do a hair transplantation, follicular unit transplant, single hair follicle transplantation. Okay, this guy has done extremely well. Sometimes we do see small perigraft halo, which is very commonly with all kind of procedures. And we need to, it will not wait for some more time with medical treatment or targeted or excimer laser or phototherapy. There's a, it's like a punch skin grafting, perigraft migration do occur. To avoid that, maybe you can take a diamond bar, abrade it little beyond the margin so that the transfer of melanin goes inside. Or you can attempt another procedure on these sides. You can do a mini punch grafting, 1 to 2 millimeter, or another session of an ultra thin skin graft, or a small melanocyte, actinocyte cell suspension. So the, what at the end of the day, the patient want no disease free. There should be any telltale evidence of a depigmented patch or an evidence that you have done a full thickness graft or an ultra thin graft, which is not very sightly, it's unsightly. As I told you, it can be more hyperpigmented. That is not a very favorable outcome. Though you have done the, you can tell the patient that, okay, I have done this and it's come out very, very well. The patient is not going to be very happy because it's more darker for him. Depigmented patches, you can use a camouflage scheme. But whereas if you wanted to hide hyperpigmentation, it is very, very difficult to do a color match from the normal surrounding skin. So all, there are many, many, many factors. Please get trained from a qualified, experienced person and start trying to do on a patient. And as I told you, when you want to undo an ultra thin, take a tomato, hold the blade, start peeling the tomato skin. So that max minimum thing, transfer, you know, tomato skin is very, very, I used to demonstrate those days. Ultra thin can be demonstrated by taking a small, hold the, wear a glove, hold the tomato, take, as I told you, the blade and thing, start seeing, sawing it so that you get an ultra thin. That can be easily done. And try to do as a test run, incubate it. Test, you can take your own skin, 2 punches you take from your skin, incubate it, separate the cells, assess whether you have done a good job. And then as a first attempt, you can always experiment on your own skin before you jump in, proceeding to a patient on the table. Another, as I told you, islands of depigmentation or hypopigmentation might persist. That what could be the reason, as I told you, the area could not have got a good dermabrasion. The diamond bar quality may be more bad, not good, or you must not have gone a little deeper, or the cell suspension must not have been alive. The cells may be a dead cell, or maybe during the dressing, it could have, the seepage would have acted here, or maybe here. So these are the other factors, but you can always repigment with a little photo medical therapy, post-procedure phototherapy or targeted phototherapy. Or you can always do, here there is no perigraft halo, not much, of course, maybe here, a little bit here. So looking into that, the patient that a second procedure may be required, but when you show the results like this, the patients are very happy because as you can see here, the young girl, the cheek skin quality, the pigmentation, the color match, the smoothness, the textural qualities, it's 100%. So one can achieve 100%. And how far? Suppose if there's 1 inch skin you want to take, you can transfer it to 10 inches. The advantages of a melanocyte, keratinocyte cell suspension is that manifold you can always transfer. You take 10 square inch patch, you got to harvest only 1 square inch skin, an epidermal graft. Why should you take an epidermal graft? Because donor area scarring is very less. It's only a smooth hyperpigmentation. If you take an ultra thin, medium thickness or a full thickness, the donor area is going to scar more and that may become unsightly. Or if the patient has got an hypertrophic keloidal tendency, the donor area scar can become keloidal. So before going into history, ask for history of keloidal tendency and ask for history of Kuebner phenomenon and make sure you dust, if you're not, patient is a little worried about the results, do a small test patch. You can always do a test patch with a melanocyte keratinocyte cell suspension. So the patient experiences the good results and then comes back for further second sitting. And if it is not responding, as I told you, non-responders are due to many, many factors. But if your proper selection of your patient is there, you achieve very, very good results. I always learn and from my patients, every patient is a textbook. He teaches you, she teaches you what best results you can always modify as and when you wanted to go. I started this long, long years ago with Professor Bell long back. And I did an ultra thin for full thickness graft on a lip vitiligo, my professor who sent this patient. So, but it's a time and again, if you do keep on doing it, probably the experience will definitely tell you where we are going to go at the end of the day. As I told you, perigraft halo, how to manage. Islands can be there, it can be also managed. Medical therapy can be followed with narrowband EVB phototherapy. If you have an exam, a laser, or a targeted phototherapy in an institution like that. If you're a loner, if you wanted to practice on your own, you could simply give a poor salt therapy, give topical as well as oral methoxysorate MOP, and then ask them to expose. Re-procedure may be required in certain cases. So always explain to the patient before we go ahead for further treatments. So going on to the review of literature, because very, very important. We learn so much from the existing literature. New literatures are comes out every day, as in COVID. No, COVID is a new textbook. We learn every day. So we learn every day from the vitiligo procedures. The original, I met Professor Gathia long back. He's the man who really invented the autologous grafting with non-cultured melanocytes way back. When 1992, where are we now? It's almost 30 years now. A simplified method for treatment of depigmented lesions. And please go into this old AID journal, 1992. Please read this. Before you wanted to venture into a topic of vitiligo, you must master all the literature findings and try to innovate every, you can also innovate your own techniques. This is a very good article. He did this from scalp hair. He took a graft from the scalp and started separating, and he raised the blisters with liquid nitrogen onto the depigmented skin and injected the cell suspension into the blister and do the dressing. To his surprise, he saw the repigmentation of the depigmented patches very, very good. We always do this technique even sometimes because time consuming for a busy practitioner, the time is a restraint. So always make sure, devise your procedure so that it's short time so that the patients are also very comfortable. Another paper, this is the original article from Olson and Jewell. This is the technique all of us follow, as I told you, preparation, cell suspension, cell transfer. This is a very 1990, right? You can also put Olson's name. You will get all the literature findings. Yes, this is the British Journal of Dermatology, 2002. Long-term follow-up of leukoderma patients treated with transplants of autologous cultured melanocytes, ultra-thin epidermal sheets on basal layers are multiple procedures tried and tested and comparative study. Very interesting article. As I told you, I had the opportunity to work with Professor B.N. Bell, our father of vitiligo surgery in India. All of us know, and I have seen the autologous cultured melanocytes. He's got a laboratory in his institute. Please, young dermatologist, I would definitely wish to go to New Delhi Skin Institute and School of Dermatology, Greater Kailash. Please visit his institute. And then a long year since I went there, I spoke to the consultant. Present consultant was with me long back. He was very happy to talk to me over phone. We stayed there. It's a very interesting. The good old memories come back when I speak about Dr. P.N. Bell. P.N. Bell also came to Chennai and saw our work and been with me for a small breakfast. I took him to Professor Patrick Sesudhayan's home. And it's a very mind-boggling. No, memories always stay long. So this is the new technique. And yeah, how Jodhpur technique, very interesting. Even I used to think about when I do the techniques, I modify myself. This is a very interesting from Sonalithi and this doctor there. So he's done even our latest conference, our Association of Cutaneous Surgeons, this technique of your platform also we shared. The gentleman came and explained. Very simple, very user-friendly, very easy. You don't require big laboratory or big theater procedure. This is an interesting article. Please go and read this article. And of course, there's a nice, my colleagues, of course, always Devinder Prasad, Somesh Gupta, Salim, we are all counterparts for long years. We worked for vitiligo, cause for vitiligo, and taught all the postgraduates in any forum. And this is a combination of follicular and epidermal cell suspension as a novel surgical approach to difficult to treat vitiligo, a randomized controlled trial. This is also available in JAMA Dermatology. All of you, please read these postgraduates. And I would like to professors to arrange for this topic to be delivered so the patient, students can go study and do it very, very well. And I'm going to demonstrate this technique in the subsequent sessions. Please look for it later. And always we need to thank everyone. Thank only everyone, no? It is only the Thanksgiving. So this is my professor, Patrick Yesudayan. I just now spoke to him before this program, took his blessings and wishes. He said, go ahead, Ravi, my blessing and wishes. So I always enjoy, yes, really mentored me on this topic of vitiligo for more than 30 years. And I'm getting a small award from Vitiligo Procedure Day. And of course, I can't forget Professor P.N. Bell, very innovative man, very strict man. We had a lovely experience with him. Of course, my teachers from Madras Medical College, my colleagues here, even now here, across India, across Tamil Nadu, and of course, not the last, the patients. The patients are the most important people to thank. As you can see, this patient, what best we can do for her. She's very worried, and she's an elderly woman. She's got two daughters. Doctor, how will I marry those doctors? And everyone refusing because this genetically determined condition, it runs in families, very, very worried. This young boy who's got expensive vitiligo, getting gray hair. So this is another one. Probably when I go into the topic of recent advances, we need to understand the pathomechanisms and the immune response to all this topic disease so that we'll have a new molecules coming up at the in the end of the pipeline. So this is again to thank you for all my patients and my professors, my everyone. So as I finish my lecture, and just to conclude, vitiligo patients are just differently colored. Let us add color to their life. This will be our aim and motto and goal to achieve the satisfying. Sometimes we may not be able to give an answer. It's very difficult, but if you counsel them, reassure them that they accept that disease, that I know the doctor, this cannot be treated well. So give them a small camouflage cream, and we have come to the end of the day's presentation. Hope all of you were briefed well, and I'm very happy to deliver this talk today on behalf of all the which I thank, and I thank at most from this pharmaceutical company to arrange. They've been doing excellent work, Dr. Rohan, as well as Professor Dr. Mr. Shikumar Nair and his whole team, the IT team, in coming out with the flawless presentations. And I would like to end my talk today, and I will open up my topic for question and answer session. Thank you so much.
Sir, thank you very much. That was quite informative and quite enlightening session we had. And we have questions pouring in. Okay, so quickly I will go to questions directly. The first question which we had, that can we discuss in brief the use of biologicals in the treatment of vitiligo? How good they are in the treatment of vitiligo?
Very interesting. I thought probably I will confine myself to this topic of interest today. There's going to be a small session on the medical therapy and the recent advances. At the during that program, I will be able to give you more answers. Thank you. Yes. Sorry for not explaining now today.
Yeah, yeah. Because then we will be revealing the suspense in the that session, right? The second question which we had is, what is the best clinical type of vitiligo for melanocyte cell transplantation? Which would be the ideal type of vitiligo for this procedure?
Good question. Good questions. Because we can't be doing surgical procedure on any patient with vitiligo. As I told you in the initial slides, we have the four segmental vitiligo is the best type which can respond very, very well with this newer technique called cellular techniques. Okay. And focal stable vitiligo, some areas of acral or mucosal vitiligo can also be performed so that we get good results.
Okay. So there is a question which says that if there is a failure of repigmentation following the surgery, what could be the probable reason for that?
Maybe would not have assessed the stability of the condition earlier.
Okay.
And as I told you, how to assess stability by looking at the Kubner phenomenon or development of no new patches or follicular repigmentation seen in the patch which we are going to plan for surgery are one important factor that is clinical, that is before surgery. Okay. During surgery, technical error can be there. There may be cell separation may not have been happening properly. There will be a melanocyte, keratinocyte cell death. If you're not incubating it properly, if the medium is not doing very, very well, all can be also assessed. That's why a test punch grafting or a test melanocyte graft is done to make sure that everything goes smoothly, because large areas have to be tackled means you have to go for this kind of procedures.
There is one combined question that is there any chance of recurrence of vitiligo lesions after the surgery? And is there any treatment protocol post-surgery?
Yes. We have never seen any recurrence of depigmentation at the sites of melanocyte, keratinocytes, or any kind of that matter, that if it can be also any type of tissue surgery. But if the disease can suddenly unfold into an autoimmune phenomenon after many years, we have seen quite a number of patients, and then we need to tackle them by proper medical care. And invariably, when you do this any kind of surgical techniques or vitiligo in different types, it is generally successful. I have not come across any patients you have not recurred later.
Okay. And before I take the last question, there is one question that micro needling with tacrolimus. Okay. Is it any niche segment or this we will be taking in the next sessions?
Yes. This will be taken up in the next for subsequent sessions.
Yeah.
Micro needling is also one of the good effect because we are stimulating this. We have the topical FIFU application, micro needling.
Yeah.
All these techniques, when I go to the further masterclass sessions, I'll be able to explain clearly.
Yes. So the last important question, what is the cost involved in this?
As I told you, you want to do a simple technique, it is not going to cost much. Because if I told you, you don't have to have a small disposable punches. You buy the surgical trays are not very expensive. The dressing materials are not expensive. If your own side lab room, you can do. You can always get small punches. Media, you can, once you buy it, it can be used for more than 25 patients if it's stored properly. So it will be very cost effective. That is why we started doing it in medical colleges. And even in a small environment, it's very easy. And it is not going to cost more than many thousands. Maybe 10 to 15,000, you can do large areas if you wanted to go for a procedure.
Okay, sir. I think we have limited time, and if any further questions are being unattended, you can write it down to Dr. Ravichandran, sir, on the email ID. I will repeat it. That is RAVISKINDOC. That is raviskindoc@gmail.com. That is raviskindoc@gmail.com. We are truly delighted, and on behalf of Brinton Pharmaceuticals, we thank you for this quite informative session, which we had audio and with video demonstration. So that gives a good impact on the upcoming students. And we are truly delighted after listening and watching you explain this innovative surgical technique on non-cultural epidermal cell suspension in the management of vitiligo. We are sure, doctor, across many countries who have attended this session would love to attend the remaining master classes which are coming up in the upcoming months. The next session which we'll have in the next month on the subject of punch skin grafts, and surely in next few days the registration link and the link for attending this will be rolled out. Till then, again after thanking you, I take your leave all and wish a very happy new year 2022 in advance. We will meet again in the next master class. Any few words you would like to have, sir?
Yes, we enter? Yes. Yeah, it's more than 1 hour 15 minutes. Thank you so much for this is a nice program. Hope the audience gets benefited from this program today. And I'm also very happy to do this the master classes today and maybe in subsequent sessions.
Yes.
And I thank Dr. Rohan for your kind moderation and also giving me introduction. And I thank all the staffs of the Print and Pharma for their good support, and also the technical team for a hassle-free transfer of this PowerPoint slides. And thank my patients and everyone at home. Please stay safe, and then a bright, happy new year, so that we all will be able to come out successfully and look for mental peace and happiness must be there for the next upcoming year. And wish you all a very happy new year. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.